Hi, I'm Gavin Syme.
And I'm Vivian Corrigan. And welcome to Perthshire Online TV on location. Isn't this great?
It's beautiful. We decided to take advantage of the great weather here in the city of Perth, and we filled the introduction here from the North Edge on the banks of the River Tay. So has it been a busy week for you?
Very busy week, yes. I caught up with Joachim Valsinger, not easy to say, and he's helping us out with the Waistline Online Challenge, because you and Elaine, well, you've been a bit naughty, I would say, haven't you?
We were a bit naughty for a few weeks. We were a bit naughty. But we managed to resolve the situation and we had a forfeit. So it may be a very funny little piece of film, but it was really hard work on the North Inch.
Have you seen it? You've not seen it
yet. No, I haven't seen it yet.
You must see it.
But it was hard work on the North Inch. You were there that Saturday morning. Alan also catches up with Suzanne Lofthus from the Cutting Edge Theatre, and they discuss her passion play. And if you remember, we had a really good interview a few weeks ago with Andy Taylor from Peel to Save here in Perth. Do you remember that one? Well, we discussed the whole Peel to Save initiative after the interview, and we were really impressed by it. So we have a little announcement this week on Perthshire Online TV, where we're pairing up with Peel to Save Perth, and we're looking to promote a fundraising organisation on a monthly basis with regards to the Peel to Save card. So the Peel to Save card is going to be on our website, and we're going to have a different fundraising organisation every month that we're going to promote the Peel to Save card for. And we're looking for existing fundraising organisations or new to actually put their names forward to Perthshire Online TV, and we're actually going to do a draw for the first organisation.
Great. What else have we got on?
I think that's it this week, apart from our news round. We've got the news round, which we're trying to encompass as many different news items around Perthshire as we can. So please bring your news to us. Remember, you can email us at info@perthshireonline.co.uk. We want to hear from you. We've been out on location a little bit with some of the news round as well. So it's a good on-location show this week.
Great stuff. And as we say, it's on with the show.
From the lovely banks of the River Tay.
As our regular viewers will know, we've been running our Waistline Online Challenge with my lovely and now slightly slimmer co-host Gavin Syme and his fitness buddy Elaine Christie, mother of four from Scoon. Now we're 2 months into the challenge and they have done very well the first month. They reached the targets that Stephen Clark, our fitness expert, set for them, but they've been a bit naughty this last month and they have failed to reach their targets. So Stephen has sent them along to Joachim Valsinger from the British Military Fitness, and we're joined here on the North Inch by Joachim today. Now, that's not a Perthshire name, Joachim, is it?
No, Swedish. I was born in Sweden, but spent most of my time in Australia.
Well, we've certainly got the Australian sunshine here on the North Inch today, so that's excellent. So, British Military Fitness, they had a tough time, didn't they, with you guys?
They did, indeed. Possibly not tough enough, I think.
I'm thinking that's what I'm thinking. Well, before we hear all about it, let's see how they got on.
Let's have a look.
Chaps, you just seen what stepped out of that car over there?
Good to get some new meat down to the park, though, isn't it?
Yeah. Stephen reckons that they haven't made their targets, which is why he sent them down.
Yeah, so it's what makes them hard today.
We need to work them out.
Definitely.
Show them what it's for, obviously. Yeah, we're going to frighten the hell out of them. I think they're some shaky knees already.
I don't want to do this. You got to just acquire it for good before they're committed to doing it.
Just go. Get back here.
Right, Kevin.
Oh, Luke, the cavalry's done the military fitness.
Yeah. Three counter, make space for the new man in the back. Make space for the new man. There, press up position. Down. Start pressing him out. I want to hear some noises, ladies and gents. Get on your feet. Today we have got two new people. Gavin, Elaine, step out of front. Say hello to Gavin and Elaine. What's your sit-up jogging on the straw? Front! Get on your feet! Whoa. On your feet! Jogging up and down on the spot. Light, isn't it? Get up in the air and be light! Turns out you're with a fit bunch, that's the way it is. Get down on your front! Get on your feet! You can double it if you're red, you can press it if you breathe.
Have you done?
But you've even forgotten how many you were counting. These guys are doing three times as many as you. You can put, keep going. Come on, 88 Blue. They're working hard for you. Do you want a hand? Should we do it together? Let's all do it together! Yeah. Find yourselves in the prisoner position now. Look in the eye. Here we go. Get up there.
Look in the eye.
All the way down. Up. Down. Up the head, nice and high. Higher! It's not a charm. We are not in heat magazine, corner.
It's absolutely hell on earth.
Teach you for not sticking in it. We sign online.
All I can say is, Willie, fight. I've never got my coffee to it again.
Are we seriously here for a chat?
No, we're not.
Well, that was just, that is so funny. I have seen that four times and I just laugh every single time. That is really great. Now, that is the whole point, though, that although it's tough, it's great fun, isn't it, York?
It is. We're one of the mottos of British military fitness is that it's firm, fair and fun. We do know how to have a good time. So, humour is one of the hallmarks of the British military. And it comes out in these sorts of classes.
Fantastic. So. Now, when they came, they were kicking and screaming. They did not want to come.
I saw
but at
that.
The end of it, they were wanting to sign up. I mean, Gavin's all for coming every week, isn't he?
Yeah, he said so. And he lives nearby, so it's perfect.
It's perfect. Yeah. So tell us about the British military fitness. What is the sort of whole thinking behind it? What makes it different?
It's all the instructors are military. Either currently serving or ex-military. Therefore, we know how to keep a group together, keep them safe. We work even at night, so cold, long winter's nights, we're still out here, rain, hail or shine.
Fantastic.
Always here in all weathers. We're able to make a safe and interesting class for everyone. We're obviously military background, but we all have full fitness and qualifications as well.
So. And you don't have to be really fit to come along, do you?
Not at all.
No.
By no means.
And it's all age groups as well, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. We've got people that have never exercised before they turn up here.
Yeah.
People end up running marathons and all sorts of fitness goals as a result of having trained with us.
And I noticed they wear different coloured vests. What's that all about?
You can see them just warming up over there. We've got... getting ready to warm up. That's not a warm up. I'll show you a warm up. You start with a blue bib, and then you move on to a red, and hopefully a green.
Thank
it just it signifies a different level of fitness.
Yes, so. I noticed Gavin was in blue, but Elaine was in red.
We put her into red straight away. We thought that that would be appropriate for her, and she did really well.
She did really well. She did really well. Well, thank you so much. It was absolutely excellent. Now, say people do want to come along, and they do want to join you guys. What do they do? How do they do it?
The best thing is to find out more information is to look up the website, which is britmilfit.com.
Excellent.
They can either print out an enrolment form or a disclaimer from that and bring it down with them to the park. But we have all the paperwork at the park. We meet on Rose Terrace at the North Inch here in Perth. But we're on all major parks in all major cities. So.
And it's Tuesday, Thursday evenings and Saturday mornings.
Yes, 7 o'clock in the evenings on the weeknights and 10 o'clock on a Saturday morning.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much. And if they don't meet their target next month, you might get them back again.
Well, we'll do our best.
Lovely. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Well, welcome to this week's Perthshire Online TV News Round. Recently, Perth and Kinross Council's Adult and Family Learning Team organised a Families in Focus event. The event was for practitioners and partnering agencies and gave them the chance to take part in a range of workshops highlighting the developments and good practice being delivered to locally to support families in need. Delegates had the chance to hear from keynote speaker author Jeannie McKenzie. The seminar took place at Fairfield Neighbourhood Centre in Perth.
I'm here at Fairfield Neighbourhood Centre. Now, Perth and Kinross have got something called a parenting strategy. So we'll go and find out what it's all about. So what is the Perth and Kinross parenting strategy?
The parenting strategy has brought lots of professionals together. Professionals who work with parents in their everyday jobs, whether they're health visitors, police, teachers, community workers. It brings these people together to look at how we can support parents in their really important role of parenting, because parenting can be a really difficult job for many of us, and it looks at the support for parents but also about family learning, bringing parents and children together to learn together. And it also looks at, I suppose, just how we can deliver services to parents in the best way possible across Perth and Kinross.
So can you tell me what the whole day is about here?
Yes, of course. The day-to-day is a seminar for professionals working with parents and with their children. And it's a seminar about family learning, where we encourage parents, give parents opportunities to learn with their children or to learn at home with their children. It's been an opportunity to have a keynote speaker, Jeannie McKenzie, who's written a well-known book on policy and practice in family learning. And she's been able to introduce the seminar today, but also to have workshops so that all the staff that are here, the professionals that are here, can attend a workshop delivered by someone who is involved in parenting or family learning.
So if you live in the Perth and Kinross area, what kind of things, who do they contact to get this help?
Well, it's very varied, and it really depends what age children are at. So it might be from a health visitor at an early stage. It might be at nursery school, where there are opportunities for parents as well as for the children at the nursery. It might be to come into something like a family club, which we run in some parts of Perth and Kinross. And a family club is just welcoming parents into a school or one of the new community campuses to have fun with children, to have dads and granddads and parents and carers and everybody playing games, physical activity, cooking together as a family, or making arts and crafts together as a family. It's quite informal, but it's an opportunity for the whole family to talk to each other, to build even better relationships with each other, and to do things that maybe they don't get a chance to do because they're busy working parents, or they're busy with other things often. And sometimes parents can feel that life is very hard. So what we do is provide opportunities, sometimes just for men and children together, so that dads get a really good time with their children, and sometimes for trips away during holiday times. These sort of practical things, as well as the ongoing individual support that parents will get from social work or community workers or any of the other staff that we have in the area. But these things, family clubs and the family line, these are for all parents, and they're just enjoyable activities with some of the learning included.
So if parents are watching this and they want to find out about all the different help they can get, how do they find out?
Well, there's various ways, but one way would be to go to the Perth and Kinross Council website and just look for childcare, and they would get information about services for children and parents. If they went into a library, they would find that there would be a family information directory for their area, whether it's Blairgowrie area or Highland area or whatever. They could go into their local schools and just ask about, you know, what's on in terms of clubs or things that maybe community services running. So I think there's various ways, but contact their school, for instance, and they would still soon put them in the right direction.
So why would you hear this event?
I've known about the work of family learning in Perth and Kinross for over a decade. I've known about the excellent work that's going on here. So I was simply delighted to be invited to come and talk to this event.
So how's Perth and Kinross doing with the family learning?
I think Perth and Kinross are doing extremely well in family learning. They've got a family learning strategy which is old and which takes in the whole range of different things that can be done in their family learning. They've also been very creative. They're doing work with travelling families, with the prison, a whole range of different ways and bringing together the different professionals who are involved.
So what is family learning?
Family learning is simple, really. It's families enjoying learning together. And it's an everyday experience. It's not planned, it's not structured. It's just what happens when you take the kids to the shops or the park, or you're sitting and play a game together at home. But for lots of families, that kind of activity is difficult. So it's useful to have people who can support families to learn together in a variety of ways.
So what kind of support is out there?
I'll give you one example from Perth and Kinross. They've got these space groups running now which are supporting parents and children early. And these groups invite parents who have got young children and in some cases pregnant mums along to share activities together with the child and the parent, to organise themselves, to plan their own activities. These groups have been enormously successful in getting parents and support involved in supporting the children's learning.
Now, but you've written a book as well on parenting skills. Can you tell us a little bit about it and where people can get it?
The book's called Family Learning, Engaging with Parents, and it's available in the bookshop or from Amazon perhaps. I was motivated to write this book because I knew of the practice that was going on across Scotland, but nobody was writing about it, and nobody had written about the theories and the background, the principles behind family learning. Nor was there an account of the different activities that contribute to family learning. So I spent about a couple of years doing research on that in Scotland, and the results of it.
Now, if a child is not developing skills and social interaction, etc., and becomes a parent, is there any hope for the child going forward?
I think that's an enormously powerful message about family learning. We can make a difference. There is no such thing as a parent who can't help the child learn. But some parents need some more support than others to be able to do that. But every parent can make a difference to the child's learning.
So what's the future of good parenting skills?
I think there's enormous hope for the future. I think our government is recognising how important these early years are through the early years framework. I think here in Perth and Kinross, a lot of effort and investment is being put into this area. I think there's a lot of evidence that a lot of change is happening.
Make sure that you're registered to vote in the upcoming council elections. Residents of Perth and Kinross are being encouraged to make sure that they're registered to vote. The election's taking place on Thursday the 3rd of May, and you've got to make sure that you're registered to enable you to go and have a vote. So make sure that you're either registered online on www.aboutmyvote.co.uk or that you've contacted the local electoral registration officer. And improvement works are planned to be undertaken at the AK Bell Library, and the library is actually going to be closed for a month during those key improvements that are taking place. The library will be closed from 12 p.m. on Saturday the 14th of April and reopens on Monday the 14th of May for a number of key improvements. Arrangements will be made during the closure to ensure that Perthshire residents do have a library facility in place. And Project Pegasus was launched last week. Project Pegasus is an initiative between Tayside Police and the aviation industry, and they met last Wednesday at Perth Airport to launch the project. Project Pegasus is a national joint agency initiative that aims to raise awareness to people living or working around local or small airfields and to encourage them to report any suspicious incidents or activity. Project Pegasus is a UK-wide initiative, and it encourages residents or people working close to airfields to report activity that they think is suspicious or questionable to their local police or to the charity Crime Stoppers. And this weekend passed, the lovely Schoon Palace, which you can almost see from up the Tay here, the lovely Schoon Palace opens its grounds for the 2012 summer season. Now, they've got a very special event happening later on in summer. In August time, they have a theatrical production. It's the first theatrical production on a tour of the lovely Black Beauty novel. So that's really quite exciting. It's going to be a great production. And it's a tour which is going around a lot of the most magnificent heritage locations and country homes in Britain. And that Black Beauty performance takes place on the 18th and 19th of August.
Fairways provide cost-effective HR support, from contracts to recruitment, health and safety to training. Fairways, working with you, for you. Visit fairways-uk.com or call Perth 632 561 for a free consultation.
I did it Fairways.
Perthshire Online TV has a very special guest. We're delighted to be joined by Dr. John Hilbert, who is the Provost of Perth. Provost, welcome to the studio.
Thank you very much.
Well, first of all, congratulations on the city status. How do you feel from a personal perspective about this? Because, as we understand, for your 5 years in office, you've personally championed the initiative for us regaining city status. What did it mean to you from a personal perspective?
Well, it meant a huge amount. I was absolutely delighted to hear last Wednesday that we'd won, but it's been a long, long build-up, and it's been a lot of work, and it's been very, very rewarding, not just because we achieved the city status, but I think there's a great deal was achieved on the way, I'm very pleased with it and quite proud of it.
So from a business perspective, you know, I'm sure lots of the business people in Perth and Perthshire are delighted that we've regained the city status. Well, what do you think it means to Perth and Perthshire from a business perspective, with us regaining that?
Well, I think from the business perspective, it's becoming more and more important for us, for Perth, to be a city. Following the last election, the government appointed Nicola Sturgeon, the Deputy Prime Minister, to be Deputy First Minister, to be the Minister for Cities. And if I could quote here from Leslie Sors, the Chief Executive of SCDI, she said, "Scotland's cities are the economic, cultural, social and intellectual powerhouses of Scotland. They are distinct and different, but their success is essential to Scotland's long-term future." And then, if I can continue with a press release from the CSPP, the Centre for Scottish Public Policy, this centre looks forward to working with the six cities and candidate city Perth, helping to shape the way ahead with challenging ideas, policy innovations, such as an infrastructure investment fund, which we've been championing this year. The fact is that in Scotland's policies are focusing on the cities. And we were last year a candidate city, and that was recognised, and we were included in some of what was happening, but not in any finance that was coming the way of cities, but we were included at the sort of policy level. Had we not been successful, that would have been dropped. There are the six cities initiative, a whole lot of things happening for the six cities, and the government, the Scottish government, is developing the six cities, the way they interact together, the individual policies for different cities, the interconnectivity, and so on. It's absolutely vital that we are part of that network.
And strategic for us moving forward.
Strategic for us moving forward. We would have been moving backwards had we not been successful. So I'm delighted that we have been successful, and it's now up to the new council, once it's elected in May, to take this forward, and I'm absolutely certain that it will.
And it's a busy year. 2012 is a very busy year. There's lots of things on. There's been a lot of announcements over the past few weeks. What do you see some of the key highlights over the next 6 to 9 months?
Well, the two key highlights will be the huge celebration of the Queen's Diamond Jubilee on the 2nd of June. We will have 1,000 pipers marching through Perth. Now, we've had mass pipe bands in the past, but never more than 200 or 300. Mm. To have 1,000 pipers marching through Perth will be a major spectacle.
I think it'll be a very proud moment for us all.
Very proud for Perth. That'll be in the morning of the Saturday, the 2nd of June. Then we have the big lunch, which is down in the North Inch, where the pipers will eventually finish their march. With marquees and a big stage, music provided by Perth's many musical organisations, Perth Youth Orchestra, Perth Choral, Perth Symphony Orchestra, Perth Brass Band, the various other bands that we have in Perth, Fair City Singers, Jamboree Choir, all these organisations will be involved in the music. And then in the afternoon there will be the kilt run, which you'll be aware, or many people will be aware, that in 2010, Perth and Ontario established a kilt run, a race over 8 kilometres, 1 kilometre for every 100 years of Perth's history, and the whole thing dedicated to their mother city here in Scotland. And the kilt run was established there, and they issued a challenge to us in Perth to beat their record of 1,089 runners in 2010. We intend to beat that hand over fist, and hopefully we'll have something between 1,500 and 2,000 runners. They will run an 8 kilometre course from the starting in the North Inch, round the North Inch, along Tay Street, round the South Inch, and then back along Tay Street to the North Inch. So it'll be a grand spectacle in the centre of Perth for the kilt run as well. So that will be a major event on the 2nd of June. And then, of course, in the first week of July, and we don't know yet exactly which day it will be, Her Majesty the Queen will be visiting Perth. I have to say that when it was announced that she was definitely coming to Perth, which was several weeks ago now, we all thought that was a pretty good indicator that Perth had won city status, because would she have come if we hadn't? But anyway, there was no certainty to it at that time, but she is coming, and a programme has been developed for her. She'll be visiting the college. There'll be a ceremony, there'll be a parade along Tay Street, ceremony at the dais, and then she's having lunch in the in Scroon Palace.
Fantastic. So, and Tay Street's looking very vibrant at the moment as well, with all the banners to celebrate the Gannachy Trust.
Well, I know Gannachy Trust 75th anniversary, all coming together at the one time. It's also the 50th anniversary of the Perth Youth Orchestra. So there's a number of anniversaries this year which are important to Perth, and which will be celebrated in some style.
So, Provost, it's the end of year. Nearing the end of your 5-year term in office,
and yes,
you know, on behalf I think of Perthshire, thank you for leading such a good office over the past 5 years. If you look back from a personal perspective, what would you see as some of the main highlights from your perspective that you've thought that was really good? It was good for Perth, or that was great because I really enjoyed that.
Well, I think perhaps the one day out of the 5 years that will always stick in my memory is the St Andrew's Day 2010, which was the culmination of the Perth 800 programme, celebrating Perth's 800 years of history. We had a number of events that day, including the inauguration, could hardly say unveiling, of the famous grouse at Broxden. And most important, we had a conference for Cheetahslow, which is important for Perth as well, on that day. We had various other competitions for schools, which came to a climax on that day, and all the events in the centre of town with the lights and the light night celebrations, which were put on by Scottish and Southern. And finally, of course, the firework display in the evening across the Tay. Never ever seen fireworks like that in Perth before. Absolutely atmospheric, and the Perthshire Youth Orchestra and the brass band playing down on Tay Street. And at the climax of the fireworks, the snow started to fall.
I remember. I remember the evening very well.
Yes.
I lived just along by the North Inch, so I had the most atmospheric view right onto the bridge.
Well, that
was
marvelous.
And the fireworks, and then by 9:30 at night, it was getting whiter and whiter and whiter.
Yeah. It was very, very good. So that would be my great day. On that day as well, we had the parade with Prince Edward, so we've had a great deal. The other royal occasion that I remember particularly was a visit by Prince Charles. He came on June the 2nd, I think, of 2010, and he visited a farmer's market. I accompanied him on that. And Prince Charles was mobbed, absolutely mobbed, and he coped remarkably well. I saw his various security men were looking really quite worried, but it was a very, very successful day, although it was quite wet, but that was a particularly successful day. And then we went after that to a reception in Scone Palace, where Prince Charles went round 200 guests and spoke to every single one, and was very well received. So that was another highlight.
Well, Provost, Thank you for your time today.
Been a pleasure.
And congratulations once again on leading the achievement of city status back here in Perth. We thank you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Passion. No, not the Les Dawson type of passion. I'm talking about passion plays. Well, I don't know why I'm talking about it, because I know really nothing about it. But passion plays have been going on for hundreds of years. But I have Suzanne Lofthus from the Cutting Edge Theatre, who does know all about it. In fact, directed a few. Suzanne, welcome to the show. Now,
Thank you. Tell us
about passion plays.
Oh, they're fantastic. They go back, way back in the UK to 12th century, which is amazing. And actually, that's where theatre in the UK was born, out of the church, a desire to communicate to society. So, you know, it goes all the way back. It's fantastic.
So, in obviously, going back in those days, people didn't read and write and used to tell the stories through stained glass windows.
Yeah.
And the other way was through passion plays. Mm. Now, passion plays, that's very good for involving the community.
Yeah, a brilliant place. I mean, they started within the church, like I say, and then when they began to develop, they went out into the marketplace as a way of communicating the Bible stories. And so from there, really, the community, society, took hold of those plays and actually began to run with them. And they got bigger, and then more itinerant players and touring productions, and evolved from there.
Did you find that... is it like a tradition that you get carpenters to play carpenters, fishermen to play the fishermen and the disciples and all that kind of thing? Do professions link up to the parts that people are playing?
Certainly in the medieval times, that's what they did. You know, you would get the shipbuilders doing Noah's Ark, and which I think is fantastic.
Yeah.
And we don't do that quite so as much now. What they tend to be is a community gets together, either an existing one, or people just come from all over the place, and they form a new community to put these plays on. And that's what I love about it. It's lots of different people from different backgrounds coming together with one purpose, and that's to put a play on.
So is the passion plays that you work on, is it all community kind of amateur actors, or is there sometimes involved a professional playing the part of Jesus and maybe some of the other parts, and then all the community filling in with all the other parts? How does it work for you?
Yeah, different ones, different times and different places. So very often it is community, and those are people, a mix of people who go to church, people who come from amateur drama groups, people who just have decided they want to come along and be part of it, people who want to do something with their family, so they want to do it as a family. Usually we have a professional actor playing the part of Jesus, and that's just a decision that I made to do that. There are lots of the ones down in England and, you know, all over the place are not professional actors, and just somebody from the local community. So, in fact, the Oberammergau one, which is the famous German-Austrian one, they're sort of groomed for 10 years before, because it's every 10 years. But it's not a professional actor. He's somebody within the community, and they just groom them and teach them and train them.
Okay, so how did the Passion Plays come to Scotland, the ones you were involved with, and how long have you been involved with them?
Well, I've been involved in them for over 12 years, since 2000, actually. I mean, they'll have been being done in different formats, although John Knox has a lot to answer for in shutting down all the theatres in Scotland.
Okay.
So, theatre and church in Scotland has had a rocky past and a rocky time to get to where we are now. But actually, there's a big one down south in Surrey, in Wintershall in Surrey, which is a six-hour one by Peter Hutley. And his daughter moved up to Scotland, to Auchtermuchty, of all places, and was looking for a director. And I was recommended for the job, as I'm a Christian myself, so to be a Christian and to be a professional director, to put the two things together, just, you
dream
know, it's
job.
A marriage meeting that, oh, for me, a dream job, and it really works, actually. So it's been great. So doing them in Auchtermuchty, in Fife, in Dundee, in Glasgow, Edinburgh, lots of different places.
So you've taken it all over the place.
Yeah, in different formats. Sometimes they're very traditional, so still with the traditional robes. But last year, I did a very large-scale modern one in Glasgow, in George Square, right in the heart of George Square. A very up-to-date modern one written by Rob Drummond, who's a new, well, I'd say new Scottish writer, but up-and-coming Scottish writer. And then the Edinburgh Nativity, which was a modern one as well, done by him. So a bit of a move and swing towards the more modern ones.
Now, I believe that you want to also, your next project, would love to do one here in Perth.
Absolutely.
So anybody's watching this, whether they're in the council or they own a big estate or something like that, or local drama groups or anything like that, would like to get involved, how do they get hold of you?
Easily through the website, cuttingedgetheatre.co.uk. Just contact us. And the vision that I have is I'd love to see one of these plays in every city or town in Scotland. So we've done Edinburgh and Glasgow, and now we've finished in Glasgow. Time to move on to the next city, so Perth.
Now, not talking about just city, I understand now why it's called Cutting Edge Theatre, and behind every successful production of anything, there is somebody who's got a powerhouse of energy, and I think that's you in this case. In fact, you're that powerful now, you're actually taking a passion play to America.
Yes, that was, I was involved in one in Dundas Castle with Sir Jack Stuart Clarke for 5 years, a five-year project, doing an open-air promenade there. And to cut a long story short, the associate warden of a prison in Louisiana heard about the play, saw the grounds, and said this would be a fantastic project for us to do with the inmates of their prison, which is 5,000 inmates there. So I'm going this year in April to do that.
Good luck with that one.
Thank you.
Now listen, if anybody's interested in helping or inspiring Suzanne how to, you know, with the Perthshire one that we'd love to kind of get going, if you've got any ideas or any contacts, contact Suzanne. You'll be more than happy to hear it from
anybody. Fantastic, lovely to meet people.
Whether it's all sorts of, and you're looking for everyday folk and
absolutely
professional actors, anybody really, musicians.
Absolutely.
So musicians are a big
you
part of
the passion. You can do anything,
play.
Yeah. We used modern music in the Glasgow one, which we might look to do in Perth. We might look to do a modern, the same
modern
one, but
version.
Actually adapt it a bit more for Perth.
And I think Perth's a perfect city for doing a passion play.
Yeah.
You know, you've even got the Garden of Gethsemane, I think, over the bridge into that beautiful kind of... Oh, we've got ideas. We'll have to get together, Chuck.
It's all coming together. It's all coming together.
So listen, if you've got any ideas and would like to get in touch with Suzanne and know anything about Cutting Edge Theatre, just go to that website and you can talk to Suzanne personally.
Hi, I'm Gavin Syme from Perthshire Online TV. We, the team at Perthshire Online TV, like the Peel to Save initiative. We were so impressed that Perthshire Online TV will be adding the Peel to Save Perth fundraising card to our website shopping cart so that you have the opportunity to buy the cards online. For those of you who don't know, Peel to Save cards are credit card sized, so they fit neatly into a purse or wallet. They contain 64 individual peel-off vouchers with great deals from local businesses in and around Perth. In total, the cards are worth over £400, but the cards only cost £10, and we will be donating £5 from every card sold to a different good cause every month. Consumers only need to redeem one or two vouchers and they can recover their £10. So it's a self-funding fundraiser. In total, the offers are worth, as I said, over £400. If you need more information, please take a look at Peel to Save Perth on Facebook or peeltosave.co.uk. Peel to Save Perth is a real community initiative and a number of fundraising groups are already involved. When times are tough for everyone, local consumers are getting something in return for their donation to good causes. Local businesses are receiving support from local community in return for their fantastic discounts and offers. Fundraisers have a new and risk-free means of securing donations, so everyone wins. This is really important when fundraising for many good causes has been cut or is hard to come by, and when our city centres and high streets are also under threat. So, Perthshire Online TV and Peel to Save Perth have got together. We will be promoting a Peel to Save card for a different fundraiser every month. We'll promote the card on the TV show and you can buy the card online on our Perthshire Online TV website. To be selected as our Good Cause of the Month, please email us with your name and contact details and a brief explanation of what you do and why you think you should be selected. If you're selected, and the selection is at random, you'll enjoy free promotion on Perthshire Online TV for that month, in addition to receiving revenue from all the cards sold online that month. So it's a really good initiative, a win-win all round. To be eligible, you need to be a non-profit group, organisation, individual or registered charity. This would include schools, clubs, youth groups, sports clubs, churches and so on. So please send in your details now and good luck for the first challenge.
Well, we hope you've really enjoyed the show this week from Perthshire Online TV. Thanks for tuning in once again. And by the way, you're really naughty to me, you lot.
What do you mean? What do you mean?
Come on, that was damn hard work, that British military fitness.
I don't know what you're talking about. Blame the techie boys.
Blame the techie boys. I think it's all your fault. I'm going to get you back on this one, Vivian Corrigan. Okay. So thanks for tuning in. Remember, keep in touch with us. We always want to hear from you. Email, Twitter and Facebook. And we'll see you next week.